Thank you. I'm delighted to be here, delighted to be at this great organization that has done such an extraordinary amount for young scientists and old scientists, but I think particularly for young scientists. As somebody who studies mood disorders and also has them and have a family chock full of them, I would say over and over again that if you have to invest in anything, invest in science. That's the best destigmatizer there is. People, when they get well, are able to show to the world that they got well, and it's only through science that advances in treatment and diagnosis are made. I'd like to talk today about the consequences of going public about mental illness. The decision to write about my illness was difficult. I'm a clinical psychologist who holds licenses to practice in California and the District of Columbia, and I had hospital privileges at Johns Hopkins Hospital. I'm someone who studies and writes about the illness I have, and I knew that as a result of my disclosure of my work, that my work would be subject to questions of objectivity by my colleagues. The deeply personal nature of my book would require that I give up my clinical practice. The professional and financial consequences of doing this were substantial. I had spent long years in clinical training and had been treating patients for a very long time. The decision to stop seeing patients would be a loss and one that I knew I would regret. I loved clinical practice, and I was very reluctant to give it up. I was as well a teacher of young doctors and graduate students, and like most people, I'd been brought up to be private about personal matters. My father, an Air Force officer and a pilot, kept to the military code that strength of character demanded forbearance in the presence of difficulty. My mother was similarly reserved in dealing with personal problems. Both assumed, as they assumed the air, the undeniable correctness of the WASP ethic that one kept one's problems to oneself, admitted no weakness. Being an Episcopalian didn't help. The frozen chosen had thawed over the years, but still veered toward immoderate discretion. I kept my fears hidden and grew up tightly sealed as a vault. I did not confess, concede, or admit. It wasn't done. I liked and believed in this view of the world. The people I most admired embodied these values. They complained rarely, and they got on with life. They didn't deposit their private struggles into the public domain. But such values were suited for a simpler world than the one in which I found myself as a young woman contending with a sick mind. My innocence decayed alongside my sanity and never quite came back. Experiences I had had as an adult made scant sense in the context of my childhood ethic. I had been brought to my knees by madness and by despair. My values had been shaken beyond easy repair. I was a clinician and an academic, unavoidably aware of the devastation experienced by those with mental illnesses such as my own. I looked inward and then around me. It did not take much to grasp that privacy and reticence, however admirable, made life more difficult than it needed to be for many people. Silence about mental illness bred a quiet ugliness and has set in place the conditions for unnecessary suffering and death. I found my own silence about my manias and depressions increasingly intolerable. True, my parents had taught me to keep private matters private, but they had also taught me to think for myself and to have a sense of responsibility toward others. I felt myself a hypocrite, a repellent state that gradually wore down my instincts for professional self-preservation and concealment. Still, I was wary of being labeled by my academic and medical colleagues as a manic depressive psychologist, rather than being seen as a psychologist who happened to have manic depressive illness. I knew that for many, the question of professional impairment would be a critical issue. This would be a completely legitimate concern. Those who specialize in psychology or psychiatry would present a special set of problems. I risked newly vigilant eyes observing my actions and appraising my moods, newly honed ears that would listen for skips in reason, real or imagined anger. It was an unattractive prospect. I would also be giving live ammunition to competitors or to anyone I had irritated over the years. More than a few. I had hallucinated and been delusional on more than one occasion, been paralytic with depression for months on end. My behavior at times had been bizarre and disturbing. By anyone's standards, I had been severely ill. I had tried to kill myself and nearly died from a massive overdose of lithium, the same medication I had written about in medical journals and strongly advocated that others take. In the early stages of my illness, I had taken it only fitfully and reluctantly. One could hope for understanding, but not assume it. I spoke with the chairman of my department at Johns Hopkins, in part because I respected his judgment, and in part because I had to. I told him I hoped it might be helpful to others to write about my oddly intersecting worlds, those of researcher, clinician, teacher, and patient, but that I did not want to put the Department of Psychiatry or the Johns Hopkins Hospital in an awkward position. We both knew the inevitability of the who is in charge of the asylum quips. More substantively, there were very real legal, educational, ethical, and clinical issues. My chairman listened carefully as I laid out my concerns. When I finished, he looked at me thoughtfully and he said, "You know, Kay, you have it completely backwards." He mentioned the legendary surgeon, William Halstead, who was the first chief of surgery at Hopkins. It was known that Halstead was a cocaine and a morphine addict, he said. When he was impaired, his colleagues took it as their responsibility to protect Professor Halstead's patients. But they also looked after Professor Halstead as best they could, so that he could continue to do his research, write, and train young surgeons. He paused long enough for me to take this in. "If Hopkins can't do that for you," he said, "Hopkins has no business being in business." He could not have been more sympathetic. He made it clear that I had his unequivocal support and that I should let him know if anyone on the faculty or house staff made it difficult for me. He arranged for me to have lunch with the president of the Johns Hopkins Hospital, who likewise gave me his complete backing. He reiterated my chairman's statement that Hopkins should be at the forefront of lessening the stigma against those with psychiatric illnesses. He also said that he hoped my being more open about my illness would make it easier for doctors and other clinicians to seek out, receive, and give good clinical care. Both he and my chairman were unambivalent in their message that they would back up my decision in whatever way they could. They gave me the blessing of a great teaching hospital. I am not so naive as to think this is usual in medical schools and hospitals. I know that it is not, but it is exemplary. And it's from the exemplary, rather than from that which is done badly, that one learns and moves forward. Inevitably, it was my late husband, the psychiatrist and schizophrenia researcher Richard Wyatt, whose advice and support were most important to me. He encouraged me to write my book, nudged me on when I balked, and took me into his arms when things were hard. He wasn't one to give up on life when it was difficult, and he did not give up on me. Prior to the publication of my memoir, An Unquiet Mind, I decided to talk about my illness to a journalist who was writing a story for the Washington Post about my work. I knew that before the newspaper article came out, I was going to have to tell my patients about my illness. I did not look forward to insinuating my own life and problems into long-standing psychotherapeutic relationships. I sought out the advice of two experienced clinicians and discussed with them a variety of ethical and clinical issues. None of us could predict what was likely to happen. Like most psychotherapists, I thought I knew my patients well, but telling them that I had a few kangaroos loose in the upper paddock, as the Australians put it, was not something that had been covered in textbooks or discussed during sessions with clinical supervisors. As it turned out, I did not find it as difficult to tell my patients as I had imagined. Most of them were simply stunned. "You seem so normal," said one. "So Brooks Brother-ish." Over the next several weeks, as I told my patients one by one about my illness, two other patients also used Brooks Brothers to describe me. This was odd, or perhaps not, but certainly illuminating. And I had to say, one of the great delights of a somewhat interminable book tour was the summer after my book came out, I actually do get the Brooks Brothers catalog, and I was reading it, and there's a woman in those, you know, Bermuda short type things, and she was reading An Unquiet Mind. So I whipped that off to my editor with great delight. Others of my patients were not so surprised. Two fellow professors expressed the hope that the academic and medical communities would become more aware of the extent of mental illness within their ranks. And both remarked with a surprising degree of bitterness that they hoped the academic and medical communities would become more tolerant. They also made it clear that they are not planning to hold their breaths while waiting for this to happen. After my initial disclosure and a session or two of discussing related issues and concerns, psychotherapy with my patients reverted to its usual manner and form. My patients were interested in getting on with their own lives. My illness reemerged as a topic now and again in the months to come, but it was not a dominant issue. I did find myself keeping more detailed clinical notes, however. I was newly sensitive to potential legal issues. The response to the Washington Post article were various and complicated. I live in Washington, and the Washington Post published this very long story about basically that I was crazy as a hoot owl on Easter Sunday, and it was the cover story. So all my friends and colleagues and family awoke to this article in the Washington Post. It was completely unglowing. I felt a discomfort in many of my colleagues and acquaintances, an awkwardness that made me cringe and want to bolt, but there was no place to run. I had said what I had said. It was a done deed. Reactions from others were variously funny, insensitive, generous, wonderful, or singularly cruel. The responses were, in short, very human. A few days after the Post story appeared, for instance, our gardener approached me outside of our house. Referring both to the article and to my rather manic tendency in the late summer months to order with great enthusiasm hundreds of vivid spring bulbs, he said, "Gosh, Dr. Jamison, if I had known you had that kind of problem, I would have planted more subdued colors." Several of my colleagues at Hopkins told me that the chairman of my department had made it clear to me that, quote, "Kay should not be made to feel that she is alone out there." I owe him and Hopkins an immeasurable debt. One day, the chief resident dropped by my office. She told me she had distributed the Washington Post article to all of the residents, several of whom suffered from mood disorders themselves. Residents and medical students, as well as nurses and others on the staff of the medical school, called to talk about their own experiences with mental illness. So too did many of the faculty, surgeons, internists, oncologists, psychiatrists, cardiologists, basic scientists. Few specialists were unrepresented. Not long after my public disclosure, my husband and I went to the annual meeting of the American Psychiatric Association in Miami. Most of the people we talked to were warm, supportive, and thought my decision to be open about my illness was a good one. More than a few, however, seemed acutely uncomfortable. They averted their eyes drew away, said nothing. I have never harbored the illusion that psychiatrists are uniquely compassionate or able to find the right words in awkward circumstances. Yet I was struck by the silence. It was bone-chilling. There was a sense from some that I should be embarrassed by my revelations, and when I was not, they were embarrassed for me. For every coldness or drawing back by my colleagues, however, there have been far more acts of kindness and drawing in. At meetings in Dublin, my Irish colleagues were fabulous. The dean of St. Bartholomew's Hospital toasted me with a glass of champagne on my courage, and colleagues from Trinity University College Dublin were kind beyond reckoning. One of the consulting psychiatrists gave me a book of poems by Yeats with a note that said simply, "Thank you." Another sent a breathtakingly beautiful bouquet of tangerine poppies and wild cornflowers to my room, again with a note that said, "Thank you." After dinner and an easy flow of wine, two other colleagues, professors of psychiatry in Dublin, took me to the General Post Office, heart of the 1916 Easter Uprising, and pointed to the statue of Cahulain, and the statue of his dying body, which is shot through with arrows. "We thought you might like to see this," they said, laughing. "He had it really hard." The Irish are wonderful. My private life was now exposed to all and sundry, and I found it hard to live with the new reality. As a child, I had been quiet when troubled. As an adult, I had hidden my mental illness behind an elaborate construction of laughter and work and dissembling. Now my mind and heart and their respective pathologies were bright lit on a page behind a lectern or on a television screen. Yet despite this, it felt good to be honest, to be a part of the community I until recently had kept the edges of. I was no longer just a researcher and a clinician answering questions about diagnosis and treatment. I could talk of my own madness and fears, feel not so distant, not so hypocritical. I received many thousands of letters in response to the publication of my book. Most were generous, many were disturbing. Religious diatribes were common. I received hundreds of letters from fundamentalist Christians berating me for turning my back on God and abandoning my Christian faith, which I had not been aware I had or had not done, for not having truly accepted the Lord Jesus Christ into my heart, or for not having prayed often or sincerely enough. I had left my mind open to Satan, and he had entered in. Madness and despair were precisely what I deserved, and they were what I would have in this world and in the next. I might expect to burn throughout eternity. I got more than a taste of the intolerance and hatred that religious extremity brings to those with mental illness. It was unpleasant, and it was very frightening. I was taken aback by the medieval quality to the beliefs held, modern incarnations of demons in possession, and by the viciousness of the attacks. One woman, it's not untypical, people write these most awful letters and then they close a prayer card. One woman who included a prayer card with excerpts from the Bible wrote that it was a good thing I hadn't had children, as I had at least spared the world of one more crazy manic depressive. There were several variations on this particular theme. "You are clearly unaware of the pain and suffering you and other manic depressives cause," wrote one person. "How could you have even considered having children, bringing up another psychotic into existence?" Many letters were anti-science, anti-genetics, anti-WASP, anti-psychiatry. It was not new to me that a large number of people resent doctors or mistrust scientists. I was, however, surprised by the extent of the resentment and mistrust. Many railed on about the depravity and cluelessness of myself and my scientific and medical colleagues. Some people questioned whether my psychotic experience were not, in fact, perfectly sane, simply visionary states or another more enlightened form of consciousness. A trip I had taken to Saturn without spacecraft during one of my manic episodes, and which I had described in my book, seemed to me, when compass mentis, quite clearly psychotic. I soon found that I was a piker when it came to intergalactic travel. Scores described their trips to Mars and Saturn and star clusters far beyond. Some regarded their planetary voyaging as a manifestation of illness, others as a useful extension of their usual mental lives. One person's madness is another's perceived gift. Some expressed resentment that I had had the advantage of financial security, supportive friends, faculty, colleagues, and family. What right did I have to complain? I couldn't possibly understand the real pain of mental illness. One colleague, hard-edged and drunk, in front of several of our junior colleagues, snapped that she thought because I had had a privileged upbringing, which actually isn't true, but truth doesn't interfere, it doesn't matter, I had no right. It was presumptuous to write about the pain of bipolar illness. I found this simply outrageous. It seemed beyond the pale to have to explain to a professor of psychiatry that the pain of bipolar illness, like the pain of cancer, does not discriminate on the basis of privilege. At the end of the day, only my late husband could make me feel less awful about the vitriol that came my way. Put the letters aside, he would say. Ignore the ugliness. If you must reread the letters, put them away for a week or so. He believed, from his own experience of having received now and again harsh critiques on scientific papers, that criticism never seemed quite as bad on subsequent reading. Often he would call friends of ours and suggest that a group of us go out to dinner, knowing that warmth and laughter and shared ideas of scathing reviews or wicked comments would lessen the hurt. Despite the occasional criticism and second-guessing, most people were kind in ways I could not have imagined. Acts of cruelty or criticism have been far outweighed by innumerable acts of warmth and generosity. For every discomfort about the loss of privacy or fear, I have found a countervailing relief in the honesty. More than anything, I have been impressed by what people survive. The pain, the injustice of a healthcare system that makes no pretense of fairness towards those with mental illness, financial ruin, violence, and most devastating, the suicide of a child, husband, or wife, or parent. Everywhere I have gone, I have seen the wreckage left by mental illness and the resilience, inventiveness, and generosity of those who contend with it. Nowhere has this mixture of devastation and bounty been more obvious than in talking with students who struggle with mental illness. I had been particularly eager to reach out to students with my book, in part because the student years represent the greatest age of risk, and in part because I, at that age, had so felt so completely and utterly alone with the uncertainty and terror of my own illness. For students who are depressed or who have other mental illnesses, the contrast is razor sharp between how they feel and the energy and high spirits they observe in their fellow students. On every campus I have spoken, students describe to me not only the pain and hopelessness they feel from their psychiatric illnesses, but the lack of understanding they feel from their professors and college administrators, the lack of adequate health insurance, their fears about being asked to go on medical leave and not being allowed to return to campus, and how aware they are that their behavior is frightening and disruptive to their roommates. When I talk to students, so many of whom have tried to kill themselves, I ask them, did you talk with your parents about this? Few say that they have. And this is, you know, in this day and age of helicoptering parents where, you know, you're sitting there talking to a student and the parents are telling them what classes to enroll in. The really subsequent aspect of life, namely whether or not you try to kill yourself when you're 18 years old, they don't share because they've, for any number of reasons, feelings of sense of failure, privacy, whatever. They invariably, the students, ask me, do you worry about getting sick again? How have you stayed well? And I say, yes, of course I worry. I worry every day. How could I not? But it is good to worry. I tell them that it's hard to get well and it's hard to stay well, but it certainly can be done. I tell them that bipolar illness is a bad illness to get, but that now is a great time to get it. Science is moving fast, and public understanding is better than it has been. I have been deeply touched by the courage of these students, struggling as they do to study and to compete, to love, to stay alive. I admire how they have played the hard, unpredictable cards they have been dealt. They take less for granted than so many others of their age. And I just want to end on talking to younger kids than college kids. In addition to college students, I've spoken as well to hundreds of children and young adolescents with depression or bipolar illness. They experience the same pain and have the same fears as those who are older, but because the illness is usually more severe in the very young, and because they cannot understand as much about their illness as those who are older, they have a particularly hard time of it. One afternoon, I went to a high school in Northern Virginia to get the commencement address. The high school, which specializes in teaching students with severe mental illness, had a graduating class of 9. The auditorium was ratty, a far cry from the elite private schools that hold such sway in the Washington area. And it was decorated with a decidedly non-traditional triumphal arch of black balloons. Each child had been to hell in his or her own way, and each had stayed in hell for far longer than anyone should ever have to do. Theirs was not a world of math tutors, lacrosse practice, and cello lessons. It was instead a world of pain, hospitals, psychosis, suicide attempts, and medications. It was also a world of grit and gallows humor. They were gutsy. They were admirable. The small band of graduating students marched to the stage to receive their diplomas, crosswise and out of step, to a scratchy recording of pomp and circumstances. Pomp and circumstance. I can count on a hand the number of times in a public setting that I've had to fight hard to keep from crying. This was one of them. Mental illness is pernicious in the young. Courage in the face of it is remarkable. I was keenly aware of this when I talked with a group of children and adolescents in Colorado. They ranged in age from 7 to 17 and all suffered from bipolar illness. We talked about what it was like to struggle with depression and mania and to have to take medications with unpleasant side effects, how hard it was to concentrate, how hard it was to study and compete, and that it was near impossible to make friends and family members understand. These were things they knew too well, too young. But we talked of hope as well, and how one could live a good life with the illness. It was hard, but it could be done. I answered their questions as best I could. Then, as I was leaving, a young boy, perhaps 7 or 8 years old, came up to me and put his hand in mine. He looked up at me and asked, "Are you really okay?" I put my arms around him and felt him sobbing against me, and I said, "Yes, I am. I really am. You will be too." I reached into my handbag, pulled out my keychain, and removed the plastic Bugs Bunny charm I had carried for years. I told him it was my extra lucky charm because it had not just one rabbit's foot, but 4. A small smile appeared. I gave him the key fob and assured him that Bugs Bunny would bring him the same good luck he had brought me. I hoped that this would be true, but the world and his illness being the way they are, I was not sure that luck would carry him as far as would be fair. Thank you.